So, good morning. Thanks. I'm very happy to introduce here the first technique here in this very first session. Also, as introduced, I'm expert for the small and wide angle X-ray scattering part at the ESRF, linking especially with industrial clients. So I work at two beamlines, actually at the beamline ID2 and ID13 for specialized SUX-VUX applications and microbeam applications. And these are also two beamlines which I will introduce in the following. So the techniques and also adapted applications which I want to introduce in the following are listed here. I go first into the field of the small angle and wide angle scattering, a bit the technique. Specialization of this is the Biosux technique. And you can all do this also with a very small beam. This is in the micro beam SUX-VUX application. I will show you also adapted sample environments to mimic industrial applications. And I will illustrate all this, just showing you some ideas how scientific examples have been published in the recent years. Now, what you can do with high-resolution SUX-VUX at the ESRF? We have access to study tablets, solutions, suspensions, freeze-dried powders. In all cases, you get information out of structure, nanostructure, for example, also molecular ordering, packing, the sub-nanometer length scale. This helps you to understand active ingredients, excipients, purity. You can see if there's crystallization, if there's aggregation in. You can distinguish different polymorphs. You can see shelf life, if things are stable, if they evolve with time. You can also go in the field of temperature variations, having adapted sample environments to really study maybe typical production processes. And also, what is very important, as we have a very high brilliance, we have high resolution, but we can also study very dilute systems, so you can detect small amounts of components of crystallization and so on. How does small-angle X-ray scattering work? Actually, it's a relatively simple technique. You have a beam, you just put your sample into this beam, and in forward direction, you put a 2D detector, is it a CCD detector or a pixel detector, and there you register a 2D pattern of the scattering signal. Unfortunately, this is not a directly imaging technique, so you have a scattering intensity in reciprocal space, so you have to interpret later on your data. The scattering intensity, actually, when you look in the formula, is proportional to a form. So you can fit a certain form factor into it. You get information about the shape of the particles, like in this case, monodispersed or more polydispersed spheres. You can also see interactions. This would give then rise to extra peaks. This is actually what you usually address as diffraction peaks. Now, in the following, I would like to introduce you three beamlines, which are specialized for three different techniques. So first of all, I will start with one of the beamlines where I'm myself working. This is small and wide angle X-ray scattering beamline. It's an ID2 beamline. It's a beamline which was in recent years refurbished at the ESF in this first upgrade phase. It's now a 100 meter long beamline, and we have here a 30 meter long detector tube with a diameter of 2 meters, evacuated to 10 to the minus 3 millibar, where detector wagon is in and can be varied from a sample detector distance between about a half a meter to 31 meter. This gives us access to a long range in Q vectors, this means in length scale. So we can investigate actually over 5 orders of magnitude in size our products. So we can measure from the micron scale down to the angstrom, basically. And due to the high flux which is available at this beamline, we have also very good time resolution. So we can go here, as you see here, this is in seconds, we can go with adapted techniques down to sub-microsecond resolution. A first example which I want to present you in this respect is an example for drug vector. And there is a very important to look at the first millisecond, how the dynamic processes are happening, how the product is fixed into the matrix. As in this study, it's a DNA physiogenic lipid carrier assembly. It's always good to look first at the constituents. So the matrix where you want to store later on this plasmid DNA is here, this cationic cubosome nanoparticles. And when you do diffraction or scattering image of this sample, you see here these characteristic peaks, which are representative for a liquid crystalline state of a cubic lattice. When you look at the plasmid DNA, you have here a scattering pattern which looks a bit more boring. It can be fitted with a core shell cylinder shape. So this is representative for this linear DNA strings. Now, when you do mixing of this, this here, you see the evolution of the scattering pattern which I have just seen you before as a function of time. You see here first the nanoparticle characteristic maxima here, which get less and less pronounced, and here the appearance of a peak. This peak is shown here in a bit more detail. This is a Bragg peak, and actually this is a Bragg peak when there's a structural conformation change from this configuration with these little channels where the DNA can be fitted in into a lamellar structure. And for this is actually the rise for this Bragg peak. You can look now at the Bragg peak area, which is proportional to the concentration of PN lipid complexes, and follow up the time resolution. And important to remember here, the time scale here is 1 second. Also we do all in the we have a time resolution of 4 milliseconds. So in sub-second range, you can have a very high resolution how these products are binding to the carrier. Another example, what I want to show you here is self-assembly, the creation of unilamellar vesicles composed of the mixture of anionic and tritionic surfactants, shown here. And also in this case, it's interesting to look first at the starting shape. So it's always a typical shape of these particles. Then they evolve depending on the concentration. Here you're in the higher concentration regime, here in a bit lower concentration regime. At the end, you see the typical scattering pattern of these unilamellar vesicles. But in between, you can have different pathways. And this was the interesting work of this publication here, that depending on the concentration, you can have either going via more platelet-like shapes or this donut-like shapes to the final configuration. And here in this slide, I want to show you that just from the tiny differences in the scattering pattern, what you see between here and here, just by fitting an accurate model to it, you can distinguish if you are in this case or in this case just by modeling the experimental data. This is a summary of this, what I was just saying. As you start with the original product, depending on the pathway, it's depending on the concentration, you get at the end the unilamellar vesicles, but maybe the way they are formed is interesting also for the real physics which is behind. Specialization of small angle scattering for doing biological samples in solution is done in the specialized Biosachs beamline, the BM29 beamline at the ESRF. This is equipped with a sample changer, so you can automatically load samples and measure them. It's also in situ HPLC is available. For this, you can get low resolution structural information of the overall shape, mean molecular weights, mixing ratios, you can study model validations. You can also do at the end ab initio models. And one example, which my colleagues from this beamline, so courtesy goes to here to Marta Brennig, which works with this beamline, has studied is here this example of the molecular architecture of complexes in malaria. So you start with the scattering pattern. You know, an inverse Fourier transform is all automatized. You get the distribution function. And from this, you can do this in low resolution envelopes of the molecules and do further refinements to get this final picture. What I forget to tell you is here that this is all integrated also in a software called iSpyB, where all the samples are exactly entered and the automatic sample change and the default data reduction is automatically logged and recorded. So the last thing what I want to present you is the third technique using now not a large beam. Large beam, what we are talking about was at the moment so beam of few hundred micron. Here in this case, we go down to a beam with about size of 1 micron size, which you focus with adapted optics directly on the sample position. This is a so-called micro branch of this beamline. There's also another branch which was opened a few years later than the micro branch. Here we can go down at the moment to beam sizes in the order of 150 times 120 nanometer. Now, this small beam you can use to raster your samples through the beam. And what samples can you put in? You can put in Pharmax, you can detect the diffraction pattern of active ingredients in tablets, tablet coatings even, you can study hair, but also emulsions and other things. The most important thing is that you put your sample in the beam, you scan it with high resolution so, and you get a spatial information. And this you can see here in this example, what I have shown you on the following slide, the investigation of a tablet coating. Actually, this is also a good example because this is based on data which are recorded at the ESRF, at the ID13 beamline, but also analyzed with the help of this company Novitom, which can also help you when you come to the ESRF to do data reduction. The study which was done is you took a tablet and you rastered with the microbeam through the surface near area. Actually, you get then for every point a different diffraction pattern. Actually, this image should be a 90-degree turn, as the inner of the tablet is up here. You scan out here, and here at the surface, we do not have much scattering. So, looking at now a bit more closely, you can attribute a certain diffraction pattern to a different, a certain layer of the tablet. So here you have more rings, here less, and so on. It gets more clearly when you do a 360-degree averaging and plot it as a function of the radial of the Q vector here. And for the two different places here in the coating, you see here in black and red two different conformations. So in this case, useful to measure the pure products, so the cetyl alcohol, the ethyl cellulose. This is a constituent of the coating of the tablet, and by comparison of the peaks, you can then distinguish which material it's in which depths of the tablet coating available. Shown here a bit more detail here as a distance of the, from the surface, certain concentration of the different constituents. As I don't want to go here into big details of this particular case, just to show you what kind of experiment is possible with X-rays. We have adapted sample environments which can be put at the beamlines. So we can have a little oven in the place. We have special cells for hosting more viscous samples. We can also have put in situ a rheometer to shear the samples. I talked about this rapid mixing device, which was used for this mixing of the DNA, humidity cells, the magnetic field. So there are a lot of sample environments which we can put in the beam. And with this, I conclude. I hope I have shown you that SAXVAX are well-established techniques to probe the nanoscale structure of samples and pharmaceutical relevance to study tablets, suspensions, freeze-dried powders. So it's the investigation of nanoparticles, molecular ordering, packing on the sub-nanometer range. You can identify physical form of APIs, polymorphs, excipients. You can detection of small amounts due to the high sensitivity of our technique. You can also detect small amounts of crystalline material, distinguish different amorphous liquid crystalline states. Synchrotron SAX allows time-reserved measurements, as we can take images in the order of 10 milliseconds for the time resolution. The thing is fully automatized at specialized beamlines like the BioSAX beamline, specialized here in the case of solution scattering. And when you use submicrometer beam, you can have also high spatial resolution into the sample for mapping of a sample directly. And all this can be combined with various sample environments. So with this, I thank you for your attention.